that same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Listen, we'll play that back one more time.
Today, many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps.
Right there. Right there. Now, many of us have seen this speech. Many of us have heard this. It's one of my favorite MLK speeches of all time, because at this particular point, he has realized, not us, he has realized many different things, and he has put the puzzle pieces together, right? And so now he's here putting all those puzzle pieces, laying them out in front of the people and letting him know exactly that he knows what's going on. And what do I mean by that? We already know they mechanized their farms, meaning they got equipment for their farms, they got free land, they got interest-free loans or low interest loans. Like he said, think about that today. If a person was to get free land or very, very cheap land and you don't, and think about that if this person gets very, very low interest rates and you don't, and then think about this, they send people to teach him how to farm and they don't teach you how to farm, even though you could be learning the same thing, right? So this is where it comes into play. This last part, everything makes sense up until there. Everything is self-explanatory up until this last part. He says, and many of those farmers are being paid millions of dollars in subsidies not to farm. Not to farm, okay? So what I'm going to do is we're going to talk more along the lines today of that topic. What are these subsidies? What does he mean by they're getting paid not to farm? Why are these white folks sitting on their ass when they got millions of acres of land, thousands of acres of land, or whatever they have, and they have equipment, and they have low interest rates, and all this other stuff, and they're sitting on their ass with money and getting paid? That's the discovery we're going to make today.
Far without bread.
Up to 1974, the U.S. government had paid American farmers $3 billion not to plant millions of acres of cereal crops. This kept the world price inflated. And as a result, the food that was available was beyond the reach of those countries on the ZAP list, like Chile, and countries like Bangladesh that were considered strategically expendable and had no reserves of hard currency. Hunger, said President Harry Truman, is fostered not by scarcity, but by greed.
Farmers, at this particular time, this is where we're going into. And my man John Pilger is the man that we're going to be looking at today, the documentarian who came up with this particular documentary and actually did the research. And he was actually doing this research around the time of Dr. Martin Luther King. I think this might have been 70, so a little bit after his death. But either way, this is him finding these things out as well. Now, he is an Australian British type person from the BBC documentarian. But at the same time, he was able to gather this information before the internet even existed, right? Because he has due diligence in trying to figure out what's going on. He's one of my favorite documentarians and one of the people that you will see a lot on my show, because he's been doing it since the 60s. And when you do it that long, you know what the fuck you're doing, right? Exactly. So, did you listen to that? Billions, $3 billion is being paid to farmers to not farm cereal crops. So not only are they paying them not to farm, it inflates the price, which causes you and I to pay more. I don't eat cereal no more, so fuck it. But for those that do, it causes us to have to pay more. And then it ends up causing other countries to be starved to death, right? We're going to pay a little bit more attention today to John Pilger and his term agropower. Now, that's not his term. That's the term he's researching within this documentary, agropower. And agropower plays a lot within the realm of what Martin Luther King was talking about. And so when we start to put these things together, we start to notice that multiple people are out there fighting for the same things. Multiple people are out there fighting against corruption. Multiple races are fighting against corruption, because as we know, corruption comes in all shapes and sizes. Let's look at what else John Pilger has to talk about. We're gonna go a little bit more into the Zap list, a little bit more into things of that nature, and see exactly what's going on within the United States and their use of agropower.
America is truly God's own country. The natural bounty that pours from this land is almost too great to comprehend. America controls half of all the world's wheat, two-thirds of all cereal foods, 95% of all soybeans. That's why President Harry Truman called America the breadbasket of the world. And indeed, she has been the most generous in the world. That spirit is now changing in Washington, the Washington of Dr. Henry Kissinger. A member of Dr. Kissinger's staff has said publicly, "To give food aid to countries just because they are starving is a pretty weak reason." In every major deal Dr. Kissinger has done in recent years, food has been a decisive factor. For agreeing to detente, Russia got American food. For signing a Middle East peace agreement, Egypt got American food. For prolonging the war in Vietnam, the generals of Saigon got American food, which they sold to buy arms. In the last few years, the world has been much obsessed with the oil weapon. But as the following half hour will show, there is a new, more powerful weapon, food. And this one is lethal. In the breadbasket of the world, the average American eats almost a ton of grain every year. In the hungry world, which is most of humanity, the average person eats less than a fifth of this amount, and that's barely enough to survive. 4 million Americans belong to Weight Watching organizations. And in the United States, obesity is now officially listed as a cause of death. In Britain, we don't eat quite as much. But like the Americans, we feed most of our grain to meat-producing animals, grain that would feed some 20 million hungry people. In effect, we choose to feed animals rather than people.
We choose to feed animals rather than people. First of all, did you notice the fat asses? Look at them, sitting here eating like they ain't gonna eat in another 2 hours. Sitting here eating like they ain't got no money in their pocket. Sitting here eating like they just on some bullshit. Either way, the average American eats a ton of grain while everybody else in the world eats about a fifth on average. On average, that's not talking about what people in poverty are eating. So think about it. If people would slow down being fat asses, right, we would actually save more lives. But get this. Not only is your fat assness fucking with the ecosystem and the livelihoods of other people because you want to sit here and eat grains as if you ain't going to eat grains ever again, right? But we feed even more tons of grains to our animals so that way we can be even bigger fat asses because we feel like we haven't killed enough animals and carcassed them up real quick, you know what I'm saying, and went ahead and fried them up or grilled them up and made whatever we want to make out of them, right? We feel like that's more important than feeding the world. Right now, did you listen to what he said? We choose to feed animals rather than people.
People starve to death for a number of reasons. The least understood reason is the denial of food for motives of politics and profit. For example, last April, in a federal court in New Orleans, two of the largest American food companies were found guilty of shipping deliberately short-weighted grain to poor countries. Grain which had been paid for in precious hard currency and had earned the companies a fat profit of $1.75 million. The companies were given the maximum fine of just $500,000. And these are only some of 65 criminal indictments outstanding against American food companies. Of course, starving countries can buy American grain, if they can afford it. But since 1971, the American Secretary of Agriculture, Dr. Earl Butz, has evolved a policy to guarantee high food prices in order to please the powerful farmers' lobby. Under this policy, the price of American grain can be kept artificially high in world markets, American farmers can prosper, and the food companies can speculate. And Dr. Butz can have what he calls Agropower. And while many people have died, Secretary of Agriculture Butz has refused to recognize any international agreement to hold back the price of food.
I'm not very sympathetic with the food needs of a nation where their governments and their leaders are constantly demeaning the United States, are aligning themselves with the Soviets, are condemning us for being international imperialists and that kind of thing. I don't think we are. I think our record clearly demonstrates we're not.
So did you listen to that? Let's understand this a little bit further. So not only does America eat more grains than it should, and it feeds its fat ass cattle and other livestock more than it should, but then when other countries want to play fair, turn around and buy some grain so they can feed their people, these twisted fucks turn around and ship them lower weight quantities than what they paid for. Right? You're just gonna cheat the motherfuckers, right? Like it don't fucking matter. They just gonna fuck them, right? And then turn around. This is your government, people. This is your government at work. Capitalists at work, and even more. You don't fuck countries over. You don't fuck people over. You don't. Maybe you fuck Fred down the street over. You know what I'm saying? He's a motherfucker. You know what I mean? But you don't fuck up Fred's rest of his generations and the rest of the people that live around him. You know what I mean? Them niggas ain't got shit to do with it. Sorry, Fred.
Mr. Secretary, what do you mean by agripower?
Agripower is a concept that we have developed here in connection with food power. I think it's one of the great sources of strength in the days ahead. In the world today, we have two major power types. We have petropower and agripower. With the zooming population of the world that's going to increase 80% in the next 25 years, food is bound to move to the front burner. It's going to be one of the most important things we face. How do we feed 80% more people than we have today? That's what I mean by agripower. I think we in the United States have agripower. We have the world's major breadbasket. We are the world's major source of feed grains and food grains that move in international channels. Last year, over half the grains that moved in international trade originated from the United States. We have that agripower right here.
This is the Center of Concern, a respected Washington organization which monitors U.S. food policy. Peter Henrio is a director.
If I have something that you need, I have a certain power over you. The United States and Canada, our northern neighbor, presently control some 80% of the food that is in international markets. We're the breadbasket of the world in many, many ways. And that means that we have power. That means that things that we want to see done in the world, we have a good, strong arguing point when we say we have food, you need food, we have certain things we'd like to see done. Will you do them?
Politically done, of course.
Politically done.
Yes. Well, now, how give us some examples of that. How is this terrific power of American food used for political aims?
I think one of the clearest things that we've had in recent years, and something that came home as quite a shock to people in the United States, was the way the United States in the early part of the 70s, so 71, 72, 73, 74, how the food that we were distributing to a hungry world actually was being used for political purposes. We have a piece of legislation in this country called Public Law 480, PL 480. And under it, we basically share with the rest of the world food. But in the early 1970s, it was discovered by the American public that the major amount of food that was being distributed under PL 480 was going to South Vietnam, Cambodia, Chile, and a couple of the Arab oil states. Basically, we were using food to shore up, to support, to win the favor of nations that politically were very important to us. I think that this came as something of a shock. For instance, in the fiscal year 1974, the United States distributed some almost 50% of the food that it sells on sort of low interest rates under PL 480, went to Cambodia and Vietnam, went under situations which, as a matter of fact, were military aid. It was not humanitarian aid. Surely it helped hungry people, but it was not primarily guided for a humanitarian reason, but for a military reason, a political reason, and that's agri-power.
And here's another part. Did you notice how he talked about utilizing agro-power for countries who don't necessarily speak highly of the United States, right? Like as if they're over there doing nothing but good everywhere they go. So basically, you have to really read between the lines. So let's say you're Firestone, right? And you go to a place, we'll call it Liberia. Anyways, so let's say you're Firestone. You go to Liberia and you want about 1 million acres of land so you can get rubber from the trees in order to actually go ahead and make rubber for your tires, right? And you're going to utilize all the easy, cheap labor in the area and whatnot. You're just going to propose this to the Liberian government at the time. That's a whole nother story. But, okay, let's say if they did, the Liberian government was to say, no, we're not going to let you do that. We'll let you do 500,000 acres of land, and you're going to have to pay your workers this, 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 and then they try to fight for their workers. Well, that's when they speak to their government buddies, and their government buddies gets together, and they start to starve the fuck out of countries. What do you mean by agro-power? We mean sanctions. We mean embargoes. We're going to fuck with your exports and imports, and we're also going to fuck with what we send and, basically your imports, what you're going to be able to get from our allies and us. So we're going to starve the fuck out of you and people until you either give us what we want or you all die. Is that the way to live life? Is that the way government business should be handled? There's so many more stories. I want to thank you for taking time out to actually listen to me and to listen to what I, John Pilger, and Martin Luther King has to say about what's going on within the past. I plan on doing many more episodes from here. This is just the beginning. I'm not going to have a whole lot of wow features right now, but eventually it's going to be a full-fledged production, which will be able to touch on current issues as well as touch on past issues and ancient issues, because I believe the past is not as old as the ancient. Now, I mean, you say past, that means any time before now, so technically yes, but you get what I'm saying, right? A lot of people study the current, a lot of people study a little bit of the past and a little bit of the ancient. I'm gonna dive very, very, very deep into all. I was about to say both, but all. Because if you don't have a full grasp of what happened before, what's happening today, and what may happen tomorrow, then you really don't get an understanding of the full story. So I want us to understand the story so we can understand what we need to do as a people to move forward in order to get to the blissfulness in life, or the whatever you want to call it in life, for us and or our future generations. I'm your boy Samuel C. Bay. Catch you next time.